Let's go to one of the Windsors. Is it Camilla? Is it Prince Philip? Is it William? Charlotte? No. It's Dr. J. Sutay. Which Windsor are you?
I'm in the South Windsor.
You're in South Windsor.
Yeah, Connecticut.
It's the baddest part of town.
Some people might say so, but we compete with Hartford.
Dr. J. Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy, and we got a lot to talk about. One of my favorite Bill Cosby albums was Why Is Snot Green? No, I think it's Why Is There Air? But there was a story that I read. It's a question that children always ask pediatricians. Why is snot green? And there's an answer to that.
Well, they say it's my explanation to a kid is usually pretty simple. I just say, you know what? It's usually clear, but when you sniff it in and you don't blow it out, it gets harder, thicker, and the color gets yellowish green. And I tell them I do that in order to get them to blow their nose. I could go into detail explaining to them how there's a chemical in it for myeloperoxidase, MPO, that causes a green pigment color as it kills our cells. But I don't think they would grasp it.
Do you know that after my children were born and I was headlining clubs, traveling around the country as an adult, I used to do this joke on stage, and I'm going to apologize, but this is why I never made it as a stand-up comedian. I used to say, folks, it's important to eat your greens. And I would go,
there you go. I like that.
Yeah. And then I never understood why I didn't get rebooked and there were no encores or standing ovations. And the fact that the audience was appalled, I would keep doing that joke. Eat your greens. Yeah. I shouldn't be allowed in public. So.
Well, in some states, that's true.
Let me ask you about boogers.
Yeah.
Is a booger snot that died?
Well, snot and boogers are all. I mean, I would say they're the same exact thing, and it's all dead cells. The neutrophils come to the surface so that they can eat the bacteria that are causing the infection, and then when they die, they release a chemical that is greenish in color, and that's what we do. And it's made up of dead body cells, dead bacteria, and a whole lot of myeloperoxidase, I guess.
And your sinuses, when you
yes.
have a cold,
yeah,
and you find that the cold is ending, and you start blowing your nose,
yeah,
things start coming out that were in this maze of sinuses that wrap around your skull, yeah. Or where are the sinuses?
No, you got sinuses in your cheeks. Those are the maxillary sinuses. And then you have frontal sinus right between your eyes where the nose meets your forehead. And they're kind of reservoirs for snot, really. So when they get filled up, you're going to get pain, pressure, headache, teeth ache, stuff like that. If you try to keep them clean, blowing them out, using saline rinse, things like that, you may not avoid the headache, but you may avoid the headache. You may not be able to avoid a course of antibiotics, which, I know that when I blow my nose and stuff comes out that looks like partially cooked bacon, then I know it's time for an antibiotic. So I'm day three of my antibiotic for my sinus infection. So
if you were to take my sinuses and unravel them, how long would it be? Would it be from
they're
here to
big.
The?
They're just big holes in our head. Sinus just means like a empty space. So, you know, as big as our cheeks are and as big as our forehead is, that's about it. It doesn't unfold. It's just a holding area.
Oh, I thought they were
as a filtration device, you know, the nose and sinuses try to grab anything that's going to be bacterial or viral and get to it before it gets into the system.
I thought the sinuses were like tubes.
No.
They're holes.
Yeah, they're basically reservoirs for snot.
And are they usually empty?
Yeah, when you're well. And then people get allergies, get swelling inside of the membranes, and they start, you know, releasing mucus and stuff like that in response to allergens. The same thing happens when you get exposed to a virus or a bacteria or something like that.
I see. Now, the ear, how big a ball of wax can you remove from somebody's ear?
I've removed some that have been quite impressive, I must say. I mean, I've had things that come out that look like a birthday candle. Like, I'd say a pencil eraser size is probably the closest.
Okay, so in other words, you're not removing like something the size of a grapefruit.
Oh no,
because
a baby
can come out of a vagina.
Right, and the ears don't stretch like that, David.
What about Prince Charles's ears?
Well, now that you mention that, I think I'm going to send you a picture of the sinus cavity diagram here.
Okay. All right. So you're going to San Francisco.
Yes, I am.
All right.
In September, I'm a Yankee fan, but I'm a good friend, and I'm going with my buddy to see the Mets play the Giants out there. That's the reason. And, of course, the day we're flying back, Yankees are playing the A's, and the Yanks are out there. So
I used to be an A's fan, actually. I used to go to A's games. For some reason, I like the A's more than the Giants. Now, there's a yeast, a superbug yeast.
Something to be frightened about now?
Yeah. Tell me about this superbug, this strange and scary yeast that people are getting.
Well, it's something that they don't have a medication for yet. It's a little yeast cell, a candida auris, is A-U-R-I-S. And candida is just basically a yeast, and we have yeast that colonizes.
Whoa. They have universal health insurance in candida.
Do they?
Yes.
I thought that was a porno movie.
You're talking about Trudeau's candida?
Oh, you're thinking Canada. I see.
Oh, okay. So there's a difference between yeast and the neighbor to our north.
I think so. Candida okay. And Canada. It's close. I think they both have the same national anthem. Okay. Oh, Candida.
Wait a second. What was the Tony Orlando and Dawn song? Oh, Candida.
Yeah,
we
that's
can
right.
Make it that together. Yeah. I thought that was the national anthem. Wait, Tony Orlando sang a song about a yeast infection?
He could have.
Okay, so I don't think that's correct. What is Candida?
It's a classification of yeast, and yeast tends to grow everywhere on our bodies. And this particular one can, you know, I mean, the candida in general causes diaper rashes and thrush in the mouth, and it's a type of fungus. But it's not a bacterial superbug; it's a fungal superbug that they have not figured out how to fight it yet. So. They saw the first case of it in 2009, and it didn't respond to the things that almost 100% of the time yeast responds to. And now they're seeing more and more of it. So it's something else to put on the back burner. They're going to be talking a lot more about developing yeast drugs. Because they haven't really – I mean, there hasn't been a new antibiotic, a new yeast medicine that's come out in a long time. They've gotten very complacent just making medications that people have to take for their entire lives and not just a 10-day course. So
I didn't even
and they don't
know
how to treat it.
I always thought yeast was something women had to worry about.
Well, they do, and men need it to make their beer. So it's their bread and beer. So it's all part of the same classification as a yeast, but these are different. I don't think your bread would rise if you got a yeast infection from someone with candida and tried to make muffins. I mean, somebody's bound to try it, but I don't think it would in the same way as baker's yeast. So.
What is yeast? What is it?
It's a fungus.
What does that mean? I don't even know what a fungus means.
Well, you got bacteria, you got viruses, you got fungi. and that takes care of, yeasts and things like ringworm and
so
all of those are caused by yeasts.
If a woman is with a really fun guy, she'll end
up... might have yeast.
and guys carry yeast.
We all do. We all do. And yeast likes moist, dark areas. And that's why babies get it in the diaper area.
Or Seattle.
Well... there must be an epidemic in Seattle, right?
And so babies can get, and it is dangerous. So
but just not to be confused. There are, yeast diaper rashes. This yeast is completely different than those, even though it's considered a fungus and a yeast. And it's got the same name as, the typical yeast. It's very uncommon, but it is cropping up more and more. And it just is making the, taking care of patients in the hospital, they've got more hygiene is really the most important thing in medicine so that these bugs don't circulate.
Okay.
And it can live, can live on surfaces too, not only on our body, but on surfaces. Best thing to do is clean.
Now they're saying that these one-stop shops where you go for a quick fix, what do they call them?
The walk-in centers.
The walk-in centers.
Yeah.
That they're over-prescribing antibiotics.
They do a lot. They prescribe antibiotics for shitty reasons sometimes. Yeah, because most of them are in pharmacies and they make their money by selling freaking antibiotics. Doesn't anybody see that there? So, you go to a CVS Minute Clinic, you're definitely walking out with some medicine. It's the only way they make any money.
So they're pushing antibiotics. The last time...
not using them as judiciously as we as pediatricians have come to do, because we see a lot of resistance. Putting kids on stronger and stronger medicines because of the resistance that builds up. So,
I recently had a cold, I would say like a year ago, and I went into one of those...
I still hear the phlegm now.
Thank you. And they wanted to give me antibiotics. I went into a walk-in clinic, and they wanted to give me antibiotics. And I said, I owe it to the people around me to not be so quick to take antibiotics.
But if you were shedding bacteria, you're probably doing more to make people sick than building up resistance in the community if you're hacking up, some pneumococcus every time you sneeze.
Then I should or shouldn't take antibiotics.
Well, if you get diagnosed by a doctor with a bacterial infection, it's not going to help with a cold or anything, but if it's a bacterial sinus infection, an ear infection, pneumonia, bronchitis, and you should have an antibiotic for that, because then you're going to be shedding that bacteria to the public. So after you're on it for a couple days, you can cough and stuff and it won't spread to people. But I mean, taking a hit for antibiotic resistance when you actually need an antibiotic, that's kind of silly.
Okay. And so I'm wrong to think to...
you're doing anyone a favor.
Yeah.
You're just going to have phlegm for more podcasts. That's all.
Do you make yourself stronger by letting your body fight the cold?
Your body does fight the cold, but the bacteria is another story. And if they're multiplying in your sinuses and giving you a headache and pressure, and your upper teeth are starting to hurt because, the snot is sitting on the roots of your teeth and you're miserable, then, an antibiotic might help turn that around quicker than, just irrigating your nostrils with saline and stuff.
You're not a medical historian, but I would assume – before the 19th century, before the 20th century, people soldiered through, right?
Right. A lot of them died, too, because sinus, ear infections, things like that can, spread through the blood-brain barrier and cause meningitis and encephalitis. And, I'm sure there was a lot more rheumatic heart disease back then, so you'd get strep throat. The strep would seed in your kidneys and your heart and your joints, and you would get post strep arthritises and kidney disease and rheumatic heart disease. So it's good that we have these antibiotics and we use them when it's appropriate and don't use them when it's inappropriate.
When you look back in history, the people who signed the Declaration of Independence, what percentage of them that day had leaky bowels, runny penises?
100%.
They felt like crap back then, didn't they?
They might have felt like crap. It just was what they got used to. You know, we didn't have anything for when you got gonorrhea or chlamydia or syphilis. And just because we have medicine to treat it now doesn't mean those things weren't running rampant, you know, when we had nothing to treat it with. I'm going to kill this goddamn dog. I'm telling
you. Don't kill him. Don't kill the dog. No. Go ahead. What's he doing? What's he doing?
No, he's just, he wants my attention, and he's starting to whine. So
let him whine. 56 guys, 56 men signed the Declaration of Independence.
And I say 100% of them had some kind of STD.
Really? I think you're right. And when they were in Philadelphia and they were cheating on their wives, they would bring a woman back to their hotel. When the woman took off her clothes, was it a
sight? She probably had some festering boils as well, so let's not just blame our forefathers. I'm sure that the whores they brought in were infested as well.
And they knew that by having sex with these prostitutes, they were going to be bringing back to their individual colonies some colonies of yeast and syphilis and chlamydia.
Absolutely.
But they had sex
but
anyway.
Their bodies, there was something about their makeup that allowed their body to take care of it and go on about life without developing the secondary side effects like, you know, encephalitis and joints and kidney failure and stuff. But there was something about them that allowed them to resist that effect of those things, and they were able to pass their genetics along to other generations. So we became a very, you know, hardy folk. And then when we started with antibiotics in the 1940s and stuff, well, you know, we started to not weed out quite as many of the duds, if you know what I mean. So, I'd say the majority now are duds that sneak through. So it's
so the guys, let's say the average age of the guy signing our Declaration of Independence, let's say it was 30. I don't know, but let's assume it was 30. If you made it to 30, chances are you were
exposed to lots of stuff and probably survived. So
you were hardy stock. You were hardy stock.
I mean, hardy stock made you live till you were 40, really. But, you know, but compared to now when we have immunizations and antibiotics and, you know, birth to three and head start and all this other bullshit, you know, we've really coddled this nation, haven't we? What, you gotta feed the kid at school, too?
I see. So that's why the millennials... It's the everybody gets a trophy generation. Everybody gets a vaccine. Everybody gets food. We've just made a weak populace.
Yeah, everyone's got a fucking asthma inhaler in their pocket. EpiPens for in case they touch a peanut.
But those are real, right? They had peanut allergies 200 years ago, 500 years ago, right?
Yeah, but because they died of anaphylaxis at a young age, they didn't pass that susceptibility on to their children. And we have now generationally passed, you know, potential life-threatening allergies on to other generations because we have the ability to treat it now. When we didn't treat it, the people who had that, you know, oh, geez, Johnny, he's 5 years old. He got stung by a bee. He's dead now.
The singularity, you know, where we become cyborgs, that's an inevitability because
we might already be cyborgs.
I agree, too. Just because the phone hasn't been shoved into our skull doesn't mean it's a part of us.
You're right.
It already is a part of us.
It's indispensable now.
Yeah. Antibiotics have made humans so weak that we pretty much have to replace all our body parts with machines. Eventually.
Right. Eventually, and that's what they're going to get. 3D printing you a kidney. You'll go to freaking,
Kinko's
and say, could you print me out another kidney? Yeah, I went on a little bender the other day. And Maybe give me a liver too. Can you print out a liver for me?
Dr. J. Sutay, how do people follow you on Twitter?
I'm at Dr. J. Sutay, J-Y-S-U-T-A-Y, and then stand-up pediatrician or comediatrician.
And where are you playing?
I'm going to be doing Saturday another fundraiser. This one is to raise money to supply children in the Hartford school system with 250 backpacks that are filled with, pencils and rulers and everything they need for the first day of school. So that is it's one of my medical. It's a medical show. All the comedians are health care people. I got two cardiologists, myself, a nurse practitioner, and then a guy who sells healthcare equipment. So it's all
And where is it?
It's going to be in Hartford at the Arch Street Tavern. You go to my website, it tells you who to call for tickets and stuff like that. I know that tickets are going. I'm excited about that. I just opened for Justin McKinney this past weekend at the Funny Bone. That was very enjoyable. He is a fine comedian in and of himself.
Yes. Very good. Thank you. We'll talk to you next week. Stay on the line, sir.
Sure thing. Yep.